Hi all, welcome back to English class. Have you all started enjoying the nature's beauty outside? And did you all observe the scenic beauty outside your house early in the morning? Just like our poet did in that poem, Sunrise on the Hills? Very good. Let's have a look at a video which tells us some significant things in life.
തന്റെ റെക്കോർഡ് ബുക്ക് തരാമോ? നാളെ തന്നെ കൊണ്ടുവന്നു തരാം.
പിന്നെ
എനിക്ക് തന്നെ കുട്ടിക്കാലം തൊട്ടേ അറിയാം, നീങ്ങനൊന്നുമല്ല. എന്താ വീട്ടിൽ പിന്നെ പ്രശ്നമായോ?
വീട്ടിലെന്തോ അച്ഛനമ്മ
പ്രധാന പ്രശ്നം. വാ, നമുക്ക് സ്ഥലം വരെ പോവാം.
Enjoy the nature and its beauty. It heals all our worries. Nature is the best doctor.
I hope all of you agree with this, right? Nature is a medicine for all kinds of worries affecting human minds. The poet, through this poem, shows us the significant role played by nature in healing our anxieties and worries. Shall we embark on the last stanza? Let's recite it together. If thou art worn and hard beset with sorrows that thou wouldest forget, if thou wouldest read a lesson that will keep thy heart from fainting and thy soul from sleep, go to the woods and hills. No tears dim the sweet look that nature wears. Here are the meaning of the difficult words. Thou means you, worn means tired, heart beset is badly affected by something, wouldest means would like to or want to, thy, your, fainting here means to lose all hope, dim to lessen. Here the poet puts forth certain conditions in our life which look forward to to finding proper solutions. What do we usually do when we feel tired? Tiredness doesn't just mean physical tiredness. It is the tiredness of the mind caused by a lot of strain and stress. Our work pressure, family situations, and a lot of other troubles can contribute to the mental stress. Sometimes the mind shakes when we face a tragedy or a disaster in our life. Apart from all this, sometimes we get carried away by a deep-rooted sorrow which we try hard to forget. So, if you people face any of these problems, what do you do to find a solution? Yes, I know you will have variety of suggestions to put forth. But the major solution will be to plan a trip to explore nature. Am I right? Yes. As we set forth for a walk outside your house, our mind gets relaxed and gains extra energy to move on. So, the poet says that if you are mentally tired, or if you are badly affected by a tragedy, or if you are troubled by an unforgettable sorrow, the best solution is to visit the woods and hills. നിങ്ങൾ മാനസികമായി തളർന്നിരിക്കുമ്പോഴോ, നിങ്ങളെ ഒരു ദുരന്തം പിടികൂടിയാലോ, മറക്കാൻ ആഗ്രഹിക്കുന്ന ഒരു വിഷമം നിങ്ങൾക്കുണ്ടെങ്കിലോ, നിങ്ങൾ പുറത്തിറങ്ങി പ്രകൃതിയുടെ സൗന്ദര്യം ആസ്വദിക്കുക. അത് നിങ്ങൾക്ക് സന്തോഷവും ഊർജവും പകരും. Here is an activity for you to do. Suggest some solutions to overcome your moments of worry and depression. Now, you may feel like asking me a question. Teacher, should we always wait for a problem to come to our lives in order to go for a trip? Can't we just go just for the fun of it? A very significant question. You should go for a trip to add on to your positivity. You are already positive, and with the help of nature, you can gain more positivity. Think about something you love to do. Take for example, reading a book, especially if it deals with some good messages to uplift your spirits. Look at these lines. If thou wouldst read a lesson, that will keep thy heart from fainting and thy soul from sleep. The two terms, fainting and sleep, symbolize a hopeless situation. If you like to read a book that prevents your heart from losing hope and refreshes your soul, does it remind you of a book you have read or a lesson you have learned in your school? If you have such books, please write them down in your notebook now. I would like to suggest a book for you that will definitely refresh your soul. It is Wings of Fire by APJ Abdul Kalam. A must-read book which will keep your spirits high. Now, let me ask you a question. Where do you want to sit in order to read the book? Yes, got it. Under the tree? Yes, very good. Sitting on the veranda. And you? Yes, sitting near the window when it is raining. Wow, wonderful. And then one more. Sitting somewhere amidst the green nature. Excellent. Yes, This is exactly what the poet wants to convey. According to the poet, if you are troubled by your worries, or if you want to read a book of your liking, you should go to the woods or the hills. Nature looks sweet enough to wipe your tears and make you happy and rejuvenated. Did you notice any difference in the last stanza when compared to the first two? What is it? Excellent! The first two stanzas describe the nature, but in the last stanza we see the poet sounding completely philosophical. Let's once again remember the skit presented by our students in the beginning of the lesson and conclude on the statement, "Nature is the best doctor." Now, thus we come to the end of this poem. Let's have a recap of what we have learned today. That is the last stanza of the poem, Sunrise on the Hills. And as I told you already, this stanza is very special. Why? Because it gives you a great philosophy of life. What is the philosophy? Yes, if you face a tragedy, if you face a problem in your life, or if you face a disaster, or if you want to read a book of your choice, you should better go outside your house, enjoy the nature's beauty, and then rest there and read. Okay? പ്രകൃതിയുടെ സൗന്ദര്യം നമ്മുടെ മനസ്സിൽ എത്രത്തോളം സ്വാധീനിക്കുന്നു എന്നാണ് കവി ഇവിടെ പറഞ്ഞിരിക്കുന്നത്. നമ്മുടെ ജീവിതത്തിൽ നമുക്ക് എന്ത് പ്രശ്നം വന്നാലും, എന്തൊക്കെ പ്രതിസന്ധികൾ നമുക്ക് നേരിടേണ്ടി വന്നാലും, പ്രകൃതി നല്ലൊരു വൈദ്യനായി നമുക്ക് ഒരു മരുന്ന് നിർദ്ദേശിക്കുന്നു. അതെന്താണ്? പ്രകൃതിയിലേക്ക് മടങ്ങുക. അതിൽ നിന്നും കിട്ടുന്ന സന്തോഷവും സമാധാനവും ഒന്ന് വേറെ തന്നെയാണ്. Okay, now it's time to explore the poetic devices and figures of speech employed in the poem. Look at the expression, heaven's wide arch. What does the poet mean by this term? Yes, he calls the sky by that name. It is a comparison like simile, but we call it metaphor. By the way, what is the difference between a simile and a metaphor? Look at this. Simile is a figure of speech used to compare things using the expressions like, as if, as, etc. Example, he walks like a snail. See, there is like there, so it is called a simile. Now, what is a metaphor? It is a figure of speech used to compare things directly without using the expressions like, as, etc. For example, he is a snail when he walks. See, they haven't used any of the expressions like, as if. So this is what you call a metaphor. മെറ്റഫറും സിമിലിയും തമ്മിലുള്ള വ്യത്യാസം എന്താണ്? ഇത് രണ്ടും രണ്ട് കാര്യങ്ങളെ താരതമ്യം ചെയ്യാൻ ഉപയോഗിക്കുന്നതാണ്. പക്ഷേ സിമിലിയിൽ നമ്മൾ ലൈക്ക്, ആസ് ഇഫ്, ആസ് എന്നീ പദങ്ങൾ ഉപയോഗിക്കും. എന്നാൽ മെറ്റഫറിൽ നമ്മൾ ഈ പദങ്ങൾ ഒന്നും ഉപയോഗിക്കാതെ നേരിട്ടാണ് താരതമ്യം ചെയ്യുന്നത്. മനസ്സിലായോ? സോ the poet uses a metaphor to compare sky to the heaven's wide arch. Let's have a look at the metaphors used in this poem. These are the metaphors used in this poem. Sky is compared to heaven's wide arch in the expression when heaven's wide arch is glorious. The tip of the pinnacle is compared to shattered lands in the line through the grey mist thrust up its shattered lands. The cloud is compared to a veil of the bride in the expression, the veil of cloud was lifted. So, those are the metaphors used. Can you find out a simile from the poem? Very good, you're absolutely right. This is the simile used in the poem. The clouds are compared to the hosts in a battle. In the expression, like hosts in battle overthrown. Here, as we discussed earlier, the clouds are compared to the team which gets defeated in a battle. It is a simile as it uses the word like for comparison. ഇവിടെ കവി ഒരു യുദ്ധഭൂമിയുടെ ആശയം കൊണ്ടുവരുമ്പോൾ നമുക്ക് രണ്ട് പോരാളികളെയും കാണാം. ആരൊക്കെയാണത്? അതെ, സൂര്യനും മേഘവും. ബോത്ത് ദ സൺ ആൻഡ് ദ ക്ലൗഡ്സ് ലുക്ക് ലൈക്ക് ദ സോൾജേഴ്സ് ഫൈറ്റിംഗ് ഇൻ എ ബാറ്റിൽ ആൻഡ് വി ആട്രിബ്യൂട്ട് ഹ്യൂമൻ ക്വാളിറ്റീസ് ഫോർ ദം. വെൻ സൺ മാർച്ചസ് ബാക്ക് ടു ദി എർത്ത് to fight against the clouds. He looks like a soldier marching. This figure of speech is called personification. What is personification? It is attributing a human nature or human characteristics to something non-human. മനുഷ്യൻ ഒഴികെയുള്ള ചരാചരങ്ങൾക്കും ജീവനില്ലാത്തവയ്ക്കും മനുഷ്യൻ്റെ സ്വഭാവം കൊടുക്കുന്നതിനെയാണ് പെർസോണിഫിക്കേഷൻ എന്ന് പറയുന്നത്. ലുക്ക് അറ്റ് ദീസ് എക്സ്പ്രഷൻസ്. ദ സൺസ് റിട്ടേണിംഗ് മാർച്ച്, സോഫ്റ്റ് ഗെയിൽസ് വെൻ ഫോർ ടു കിസ് ദ സൺ ക്ലാഡ് വെയിൽസ്, ദേ ഗ്യാദേർഡ് മിഡ് വേ റൗണ്ട് ദ വുഡഡ് ഹൈറ്റ്, ദ മെലോ ബ്ലഷ് ഓഫ് ഡേ. ദ സൺ ഇസ് പെർസോണിഫൈഡ് ആസ് എ സോൾജിയർ who marches to the field. And in the expression gales and whales, that is the wind and the valley, are personified as lovers. Gales come to kiss the valley. Clouds are also personified. How? The cloud here stands for the soldiers from the enemy kingdom. What about the beautiful nature? Yes. It blushes with shyness like a bride when it's touched by the powerful bridegroom sun. So, the nature is personified as a bride whose face become rose in color. ഇവിടെ സൂര്യനെ ഒരു ശക്തമായ പോരാളിയായും മേഘങ്ങളെ ശത്രുപക്ഷത്തെ പോരാളികളായും വർണ്ണിച്ചിരിക്കുന്നു. പ്രകൃതിയെ ഒരു സുന്ദരിയായ വധുവായും സൂര്യനും കാറ്റും പ്രകൃതിയുടെ കാമുകന്മാരായും വർണ്ണിച്ചിരിക്കുന്നു. ഡു യു റിമെമ്പർ ദ ടേം സോഫ്റ്റ് ഗെയിൽസ്? വാട്ട് വാസ് സ്പെഷ്യൽ അബൌട്ട് ദാറ്റ് ടേം? യെസ്, ഇറ്റ് വാസ് കോൺട്രഡിക്ടറി. വാട്ട് യു മീൻ ബൈ ദ വേർഡ് കോൺട്രഡിക്ടറി? ഇറ്റ് മീൻസ് ഓപ്പോസിറ്റ് ഇൻ മീനിങ്. ഹിയർ ദ പോയറ്റ് describes a strong wind as soft. So we can say that the words soft and gales are contradictory. We have yet other contradictory terms coming together. In merry shout, shout means a loud cry, but the cry is coming out of happiness. The positive term merry is attached with the slightly negative term shout. This figure of speech is called oxymoron. What is an oxymoron? A figure of speech in which apparently contradictory terms appear together. Example, soft gales, merry shout. Did you notice that? വിപരീത അർത്ഥമുള്ള രണ്ട് പദങ്ങൾ ഒരുമിച്ച് വരുന്നതിനെയാണ് ഓക്സിമോറൺ എന്ന് പറയുന്നത്. കെൻ യു കോയിൻ സം ഓക്സിമോറൺസ് യുവർ സെൽഫ്? പ്ലീസ് ട്രൈ ടു ഡു ഇറ്റ് വെൻ യു ഗെറ്റ് ടൈം. ലെറ്റ് മീ ഗിവ് യു സം അതർ എക്സാമ്പിൾസ് ഓഫ് ഓക്സിമോറൺ ദാറ്റ് ഡോണ്ട് അപ്പിയർ ഇൻ ദിസ് പോയം. ചെക്ക് ദീസ് ഔട്ട്: സ്വീറ്റ് പെയിൻ, ടെറിബിൾ ബ്യൂട്ടി, സീരിയസ്ലി ഫണി. യെസ്, ഹൗ ഫണി ഇറ്റ് ഈസ്, റൈറ്റ്? Why do the poets employ oxymorons in poems? Do you know? No idea? Okay, I'll tell you. It actually adds beauty to the poem. It makes the readers curious and excited to explore the deeper meanings of the poem. So, here onwards, when you write poems, try to add such figures of speech. Okay, dear children? Right. We are still not over. We have yet to explore the poetic devices used in the poem. As you must have noticed, the poem is an elegant mixture of visual images, sounds and movements. We feel as though we are standing in the position of the poet and watching things down there, don't we? Yes. Why do we feel that? Because of the clever usage of the poetic devices. Let's take them one by one. First one is alliteration. What is alliteration? It is a repetition of consonant sounds in the beginning of the neighboring words in a line. Example: sweet birds sang. See, the letters SS are getting repeated. Fish fry, fur fur sound. Then blessed barrier, bur bur sound. ഒരു വരിയിൽ ഒരു വ്യഞ്ജനാക്ഷരം ആവർത്തിച്ചു വരുന്നതിനെയാണ് അലിട്രേഷൻ എന്ന് നമ്മൾ വിളിക്കുന്നത്. Can't you find out the alliterating words in this poem? Find out now. Good. Yes, you're all very smart. How quickly you found out. These are some of the main alliterating words in this poem. Woods were brightened. That you can see. Wood, wood, wur, wur sound. Beneath me bathed. Bur, bur sound is getting repeated. Blasted bear, again bur sound. Wheeled a spiral way, wur sound. Distant waters dash, dur sound is there. Blue lakes, silver beach, again the bur sound is getting repeated. Faint and far, fur sound. Through thick leaved, the third sound gets repeated. Okay? So, what is the use of alliteration in a poem? It gives a musical quality to the poem which makes it interesting to read. The poem is packed with a lot of images too. What are poetic images? The poetic images are those elements in the poem that appeal to any of our five senses. Which are our five senses? Sight, sound, smell, touch and taste. Very good. We have plenty of visual, auditory, tactile and kinesthetic imagery in the poem. Are you confused with the words? Don't worry, I'll tell you the meaning. Visual means the images we can see. Auditory, the images we can hear. Tactile are the images we can touch and feel. And kinesthetic are images of movement. Let's get started with the visual images. You can easily pick them out from the poem. Please keep a notebook ready so that As we pick out the images, you can write them down. Are you all ready with the book? Shall we start? Let's do it together. Yes, great. Arch. Woods. Very good. Sun-clad veils. Clouds. Pinnacle. Dark pine. Very good. Cascade. Bittern. Yes, we have more and more. Distant waters flashing. Blue lake. Silver beach. Smoke. Thick-leaved branches. So and so. What about the auditory images or the images that appeal to your ears? Great attempt! Wow! The music of the village bell. The echo of the bell. Wild horn's voice. And the merry shout. Very good. Next, we move on to the images you can touch and feel. Why? Are you confused? You're not getting anything? Didn't you feel a cool wind coming and touching in the beginning of the poem? Exactly, you said it. Soft gales went forth to kiss the sun-clad vales. This comes in the third line of the poem. And finally, let's hunt the images of movement. I'm sure you can do it without difficulty. Rocking cliff, very good. Noisy bittern's spiral way. Then, distant waters dashing and whirling. And the woods bending. Okay, very good. So now we come to the end of the poetic devices and figures of speech used in the poem. Now it's time for your assignment. This is your assignment question. What message does the poet convey through the poem, Sunrise on the Hills? Write the answer down in not more than 80 words. Let me repeat it. What message does the poet convey through the poem Sunrise on the Hills? Write the answer down in not more than 80 words. Please write the answer down in your notebook and send it to your English teacher. So, with this, we are winding up the session. Thank you all and goodbye.